सर
सर
மேடம் சொல்லுங்க.
ஆ சார், நம்ம ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாம் சார்.
ஆ ஓகே மேடம். இதை மேடம் வீடியோ ஆன் பண்ணுமா மேடம்? மேடம்
சார் ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாம் சார், லைவ் போயிட்டு இருக்கு.
வீடியோ ஆன் பண்ணலாமான்னு கேக்குறேன்.
ஆ பண்ணலாம் சார்.
ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாமா?
ஆ ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணலாம் சார்.
ஆஃப்டர்நூன் டு எவ்ரிபடி. திஸ் இஸ் பரதன், அசோசியேட் ப்ரொஃபஸர் ஆஃப் எக்கனாமிக்ஸ், பிரசிடென்சி காலேஜ், சென்னை. In my earlier class, I spoke about public revenue, public finance and public revenue. So in this class, I would like to discuss the public expenditure aspect of public finance. Okay. So I start with public expenditure. What is public expenditure? We know. The expenditure of the government is called the public expenditure. The government spend for different spend public revenue for different purposes. So those spending is called the public expenditure. So in other words, whatever the amount the government spend for the people or in this society, that's called the public expenditure. And the screen that shows public expenditure is classified into before 1987-88, it was classified into civil expenditure, defense expenditure, grants and aid, development expenditure. This is one category. Another category is defense expenditure and other expenditure. So under civil expenditure, most of the public expenditure activities are undertaken under this head, civil expenditure. And defense expenditure is known to everybody, and other expenditure that includes subsidy and other aspects. Okay, So the new classification of public expenditure is presented in the next slide that shows the public expenditure of a country is divided into revenue expenditure and capital expenditure. That is the expenditure made by the government from the revenue resources or revenue receipts. That is called the revenue expenditure. And the expenditure made by the government from borrowing from any sources. That is called the capital expenditure. So this is another type of classification that was adopted from 1987-88 budget onwards. And the non-plan revenue expenditure that includes the following activities. In the slide, you can find non-plan expenditure is financed out of revenue receipts, that is tax revenue and non-tax revenue. This includes, this non-plan expenditure includes interest receipt, defense revenue expenditure, major subsidies. Major subsidy includes food subsidy, fertilizer subsidy, and export promotion subsidy and other subsidies. And in addition to that, debt to farmers, postal deficit, police pension, etc. These are all coming under non-plan expenditure. Social expenditure that is given, health, education, and broadcasting. Economic services that includes agriculture, industry, power, transport, communication, science and technology, etc. Grants and aid to state and union territories. These are all coming under non-plan revenue expenditure. So a country spends more on this non-plan expenditure. And non-plan capital expenditure includes, you know, given four different heads: defense capital expenditure, loans to public enterprises, loans to states and union territories, and loans to foreign governments. So these are all coming under non-plan capital expenditure. So in the next information given, non-plan expenditure, both revenue and capital account, has increased from 64,500 crore in 1989-92, 9,69,900 crore in 2012-13. So it is nearly 15 times increase in 13 years. So non-plan expenditure has increased tremendously in this period from the date of liberalization to 2012-13. And next one is, this is very important aspect of public expenditure, trends in expenditure of the central government. The expenditure of the central government is growing at an alarming rate. The data shows that in 1950-51, it is given 1950-50, is not 1950-51, the revenue expenditure of the government of India was 350 crores. This has increased to 12,86,109 crores in 2012-13. So this is with reference to growing revenue expenditure. The non-development expenditure continue to be a large proportion to the total expenditure. That is defense expenditure, debt services, and administrative expenses. This consists of a very large share of non-development expenditure. The data shows that in 1980, the non-development expenditure was around, annual increase was around 5,000 crore. In the 90s, it was 10,000 crore. So interest payment and defense expenditure, subsidies and general services, that is equal to 90% of non-plan expenditure. So the head defense expenditure and interest payment that account for nearly 40% of the government budget. The revenue from the revenue to the central government, 40% of the revenue to the central government, that goes only to interest payment, defense expenditure. So in that aspect, these two are very important. This is the second aspect. And third one is ratio of public expenditure to GDP. This is another important aspect of public expenditure. Here, what is the proportion of GDP meant for public expenditure? So in 1951, the data shows in 1951, it was only 9.1%. Gradually, the percentage of public expenditure to GDP that has increased from 9.1 to 15.3 in 60-61, then 17.2 in 70-71, 25.6% in 80-81, 28.5% in 90-91. The remaining, I have to fill some more. So the expenditure, public expenditure to GDP, that is nearly 25%. Until 1991, the public expenditure has grown steadily. In 97-98, the ratio of public expenditure to GDP was 24.9%. And in 2007-08, it was nearly, or it was 28.4%. So nearly 30% of the GDP is spent by the government as public expenditure. So this part is very important. And another important aspect of public expenditure is ratio of development expenditure to total expenditure. You know what is development expenditure? Generally, we classify the expenditure into development and non-development. Here, the developmental expenditure in 1950-51 was only 36.2%, and 2007-08, it was 55%. So, developmental activities that is contributing, or that share is more than 55%, that shows the importance of developmental activities in this country. I think even in 1991, the ratio of developmental expenditure to GDP was nearly 60%. Okay, so this running information will be more useful. The defense expenditure, interest payment on public debt, tax collection charges, and police accounted for 2/3 of the total non-developmental expenditure of the country. So this information is very useful. And the ever-increasing public debt and other liabilities, interest burden of the central government is going to increase. In 1989-90, this public debt and liability that was 9,250 crore, it has increased to 21,500 crore in 1990-91. And in the year 2012-13, it was around 3,19,759 crores. So the head public debt, I mean debt services and interest, I mean defense expenditure. So these two are showing very high proportion of non-developmental expenditure. And defense expenditure, I've given in the next data, the defense expenditure on revenue account has increased from 10,870 crore in 1991 to 1,14,829 crores in 2013. That shows the importance of defense expenditure in India. And the subsidies, the major subsidies, food subsidy, fertilizer subsidy, and the export promotion subsidy has increased as in the case of other expenditure. In 85-86, 4,900 crores of subsidies were spent. In 1991, 12,160 crore. In 2012-13, it was 190,015 crores. So the subsidies that plays an important role, or that is consuming a major part of government revenue. It is around 6% of GDP spent for subsidies. The expenditure on general services, that has also increased from 2,060 crores in 85-86 to 1991 in 6,850 crores in 1991 and 241,993 crores in 2012-13. So this is the general trend of non-developmental expenditure in India, and this is with particular reference to public debt interest repayment. So interest repayment is the single largest central government expenditure in India. So it was around 319,759 crores. It was around 11% of current revenue expenditure in 1950-51. But in 2086, it was 20%. And in 2012-13, it was 25% of the current revenue expenditure of the country. So the public debt component and its interest payment is a major public expenditure part of the central government. The public debt and other liabilities of the country, the data shows in 1950-51, 2,864. But in 2013, it was 50,35,072 crores. Even in 2019-20, it was nearly 80 lakhs crore. So the public debt has increased enormously, even in the post-liberalization period. And the next one is trends in revenue expenditure of states. The state governments are also spending their tax revenue. The data about the states is given in this slide. There is a rapid increase in revenue expenditure of almost all states in India. The data again shows in 1950-51, the revenue expenditure of all the states in India was only 392 crores, but it has increased to 14,800 crore in 1980-81, 6,91,401 crore in 2008-09. So the developmental expenditure has become more important than non-development expenditure in states, because defense expenditure and debt services are mostly spent by the central government. So the state government is concentrating more on developmental expenditure. Again, the table shows the developmental expenditure and non-developmental expenditure of states. 1951-52, the developmental expenditure and non-developmental expenditure are equal, that is 50-50. But in 2008-09, the developmental expenditure is 62%, whereas non-developmental expenditure is only 38%. So the states are concentrating more on developmental expenditure as per the data. Okay, and this particular slide that shows trends in revenue expenditure of the central and state government. Both central and state government taken together, the combined total expenditure exceeded the combined total current receipts of the country. This resulting in a gap called gross fiscal deficit, the ratio of tax to GDP. That is given in the next table that shows in 1950-51, only 6% of GDP is collected as tax. But in 1970-71, that is 14%. In 2008-09, the percentage of GDP collected as tax is nearly 21.6%. Even now, it is nearly 23%, 24%. Okay, 1 minute. So the tax GDP ratio. Tax GDP ratio shows that the government that collects a major percentage of GDP as tax, both direct and indirect tax. The ratio of direct to indirect taxes was this was 35%. 35% is direct tax and 65% is indirect tax in 1950-51. But in 2008 and 2009, the ratio of direct tax is 40% and the ratio of indirect tax is 60%. So the indirect taxes are contributing more to the country than direct taxes. But now in 2019-20, indirect taxes are contributing less than the direct taxes. That is, in 2019-20, direct taxes are contributing 22% and indirect taxes are contributing 48% to the GDP. That shows that the share of direct taxes are increasing, which means the economy is growing. Whenever or when the economic development of a country takes place, the contribution of the direct taxes should be more. The indirect taxes contribution should start declining. That is the symptom for the economic development of a country. So this is the trend. And next one is debt position of the state. You know, public debt and debt position of the states. So again, as in the case of central government, state governments are also borrowing from internal sources and external sources. The internal debt of states that comprises of these three sources: current market term loans and bonds, ways and means advances, and loans to banks, institutions, etc. So internal debt of states comprises of these three debts. And second one is loans and advances from the central government for plan expenditure and non-plan expenditure purposes. This is the second category of borrowing of the state. The third one is provident fund, state provident fund, insurance and pension fund. Pension funds are used by the states for the economic development or for, to finance the deficit of the states. So these are the three sources from which the state governments can mobilize funds to finance the deficit. So in the year 1961, the public debt of states was 2,740 crores. All the state governments taken together, their public debt was only 2,740 crores. But in 2019, it was around 14,51,000. 26 crores. That means the public debt of state governments has increased very faster than central government, because most of the developmental activities or most of the schemes are implemented by the state governments, but majority of revenue sources are with the central government. So the state governments, they have no other opportunity to mobilize resources other than going for public. So they go for borrowing from central government or from the public or from the international agencies. So this is the debt position of the states. The next point shows the state debt GDP ratio is 28%. The debt GDP ratio is different. States debt GDP ratio is 28%. Internal debt of states was 22% of all states' liabilities in 1960. In 2008-9, it was 64%. Interest burden of states has risen from about 15% in 1961 to about 29% in 2008-9. So the share of central government loans and advances in the total debt of states declining from 74% to 11% in 2009, which means the state governments, they directly mobilize resources from the from different sources. So the dependency of central government is declining, and state governments, they mobilize their own resources for their developmental activities. So this is reference to debt position of the states. And next one is, this is very important. We discussed earlier, a country can get revenue, can mobilize revenue for different activities. The mobilized revenue, tax revenue, whether it is tax revenue or non-tax revenue, that revenue is spent on different purposes. So a country is involving, or a country is collecting revenue, that revenue is spent for different purposes. So public revenue and public expenditure are two important aspects of public finance that we discussed in the last class. If there is a gap between revenue and expenditure, the revenue is less, expenditure is more. We said the budget is deficit budget. So in that case, the deficit amount, the gap in revenue and expenditure, that is financed through deficit financing. So deficit financing means expenditure of a country is more than the revenue of a country, so that the difference amount is mobilized from various sources. That is what we call it as deficit financing. So deficit financing is mostly used for developmental expenditure of a country. So deficit financing of a government is through these three sources. The slide shows by running down cash balances with RBA. You know, all state governments and central government, they have their account in RBA, so their balances will go down. Even they withdraw, or what is that? More than the revenue collected, that amount is used for financing a deficit. And the more important is, the second point is more important, that is borrowing from the market. A state government that goes for public debt or borrowing from the market, that is from the public. And third one is borrowing from the RBA. So these three are important sources of financing a deficit. Okay, then there are some types of deficit. So we know fiscal deficit, we know budgetary deficit, and in that process we said revenue deficit, fiscal deficit, primary deficit, etc. So the revenue deficit is defined like this: revenue deficit equal to, because revenue deficit is the difference between revenue receipts and revenue expenditure. That is, revenue receipts, this includes tax revenue and non-tax revenue. So that is the revenue receipts. From this revenue receipts, the revenue expenditure is made. If there is a gap between these two, that deficit is called revenue deficit. So in 1990-91, I hope you would understand, revenue deficit is equal to revenue assets minus revenue expenditure. In 1991, the revenue deficit was 54,950 crore and the revenue expenditure was 73,510 crore. That means there was a revenue deficit of 18,560 crore in 1919. So, Krishnamachari Commission that recommended the deliberate adoption of revenue surplus as budgetary policy during the first plan. So, based on this, the period 1951 to 1975, the government of India that got more revenue surplus. So, between these, between the period, between 25 years period, the budget, revenue budget was surplus. And we know revenue budget and capital budget. So there is a deficit in capital budget, but the revenue budget shows surplus during this period. And the budget deficit, as in the as we discussed earlier, revenue deficit, deficit is budget deficit. Budget deficit is equal to total receipts. Total receipts means revenue receipts plus capital receipts minus total expenditure. So, budget deficit is equal to total receipts minus total expenditure. Total receipts include total revenue receipts and total capital receipts. Total expenditure includes total current expenditure and total capital expenditure. So, the difference between these two is called budget deficit. Budget deficit is also called overall budget deficit, in which total expenditure exceeds total receipts. This is called deficit financing by the Ministry of Finance. Okay, so revenue deficit, that will not be treated as deficit financing. Only the budget deficit is accepted, that is treated as deficit financing by the Ministry of Finance in India. And next one is one minute. Primary deficit. This is very important. Fiscal deficit, a country should stabilize the fiscal deficit of a country. The fiscal deficit is equal to revenue receipts plus capital receipts minus total expenditure. So this is the definition for fiscal deficit. This includes budgetary deficit plus market borrowing. Market borrowing is nothing but public debt. In other words, capital assets, other liabilities of the government of India. So it shows the gap between government receipts and government expenditure. So fiscal deficit is an important aspect of a budget. And another type of deficit called the primary deficit. This is equal to fiscal deficit minus interest payment. So interest payment is an important component, as I told you earlier. Fiscal primary deficit is what is equal to fiscal deficit minus interest payment. Interest payment is nearly 25% of our budgetary expenditure. So this deficit has no policy significance. I mean, primary deficit has no policy significance. We give more importance to fiscal deficit and budget deficit. Even revenue deficit is also important, but primary deficit is only for our understanding. Deficit financing trends in recent years. Again, this is statistical information. The revenue deficit has increased very fast from 2560 crore in 1991 to 2010. So one understand the size of deficit budget, because deficit budget create a lot of disturbances in the economy, because prices will increase, the value of money will decline. So these things, these effects will happen if the size of deficit is increasing. So in this data, it is shown from the period 1991 to 2010, the amount of deficit was increased from 18,560 crores to 2,82,735 crores. So that shows the deficit is not advisable. That is not good for a nation. Okay. So this is the first point, and it was 3.5% to 4.7% of GDP. Generally, the various committees that recommend the deficit budget should not be more than 3% of GDP. That should be controlled within 3%. In the 90s, after what is that, 2000, the percentage of deficit has increased to 5%, 6%, even sometimes 7%. In 1991, the fiscal deficit was around 7% of GDP. So that percentage of GDP was not good for the nation, okay? Because that will create so many economic problems. And in the last 4 years, revenue deficit has declined to 1.5% of GDP. Okay. Originally, budget deficit was calculated to show RBI lending to the government. Since 1997, RBI lending to the government through product treasury bill was given up. So the concept of lost significance. The finance ministry has so estimated the capital receipts that the total receipts of the government are exactly equal to total expenditure. So there is no overall budget deficit. The government used the 91 days treasury bill from the market. This would be part of the capital receipt under the heading borrowing and other liabilities. Fiscal deficit has grown rapidly and dangerously from 27,040 crores in 1988-89 to 44,630 crores in 1991, and further it has increased to 4,996 crores in 2007-8 budget. So as I told you earlier, this fiscal deficit is a highly disturbing factor in the economy. Okay. Effects of deficit budgeting. This is a theoretical concept. We need to understand what is the effect of deficit financing, because deficit financing, as we know well, the expenditure of the country is more than the revenue of the country. So there is a mismatch. That mismatch is financed through various activities, either by borrowing or by disinvestment, etc. So, what is the effect of this deficit on the economy? In the economy, what the effects deficit financing will create? So, deficit financing and expansion in public debt and other liabilities. Public debt and other liabilities has increased from 10 times to 10 times, that is 1000%, the public debt has increased. The annual average growth rate of public debt was around 12.4% during 1991 to 2009-10. Nearly 48% of current tax revenue of the center goes towards the payment of interest. So this is very important. Nearly 48% of current tax revenue of the central government goes to towards interest payment. And the deficit financing that will create inflationary pressure that leads to force the saving, the changes in the pattern of investment, and credit creation by banks. So these problems will arise due to deficit financing. And, I think you can understand inflationary pressure, changes in the pattern of investment, credit creation, etc. Do you know what is the meaning of forced saving? If we this point, I would like to explain. Forced saving is nothing but compulsory saving by the employees of organizations. For example, Provident Fund is a forced saving because nobody is interested to contribute towards Provident Fund, or they are not willingly contributing. The law says that this percentage of income should be contributed towards Provident Fund. So that is called a forced saving. So forced saving will increase. Even in India, all these savings are Provident Fund, State Provident Fund or General Provident Fund amount are used by the government to finance the deficit. So these things will happen. These effects will happen if deficit financing in a country is increasing uncontrollably. Okay. So this is the effect. And I think this you don't want. Taxation Inquiry Committee. This is very important. Tax Commission, when we know revenue and expenditure of a country, the revenue is less than the expenditure, and the responsibilities of state government is more than the central government, because most of the schemes are implemented by the central government, but the state government, but tax collecting. Right is with the central government, so they collect major taxes, or major tax revenue goes to the central government, and only very few taxes are with the central government. So, sorry, with the state government. So, the revenue is with the central government, but the responsibilities are with the state government. In such cases. The state government, they need to get the share of taxes from the central government. So for this particular purpose, the Finance Commission was appointed by the President of India, by the government. So every 5 years, a Finance Commission is appointed by the government, or it is for the period of 5 years period. It is for the purpose of sharing tax revenue between the state and center. That is, the central revenue is shared with the state. So that is the main function of, or that is the purpose for which Finance Commission was appointed. And the information that is in the slide. Finance Commission is the quasi judicial body. Article 288 of the Indian Constitution that empowers the President to appoint the Finance Commission for every 5 years for the specific purpose of devolution of non-planned revenue resources. That is, devolution is nothing but sharing the tax revenue of the central government is shared with the state. So it makes recommendation for all these four different aspects. In the functions of a Finance Commission are given in this slide. There are four functions: distribution of net proceeds of taxes to be shared between the union and states, the principles governing the grants and aid. So this is what I would like to explain. Grants and aid of the revenue of the states and any agreement between central and state government, any new agreement or modification that can be done on the basis of the recommendations of the Finance Commission, and any other matter concerning the financial relation between union and states. So that is the function of Finance Commission. So in simple terms, Finance Commission is appointed once in 5 years. It is for the purpose of sharing the tax revenue between the center and states, because center's tax revenue is shared with the states. For this purpose, they the planning committee, the president that appoints the Finance Commission, shows various Finance Commission and their chairman. Okay. Oh, just a minute. I'll come back. A little slide, but I will explain. You please listen. The deficit, fiscal deficit of the country. That is increasing in the from 1915-16 budget onwards. The fiscal deficit is increasing, and the percentage is also given. The fiscal deficit is nearly explain the fiscal deficit. The borrowing, market borrowing is the major. Yes, market borrowing, that is that consists of nearly 72% of the fiscal deficit. It was nearly 85% in 2015-16 budget, and 66% in 16-17, 77% in 17-18 budget, and now 70% in 18-19 budget. So that shows the fiscal deficit of the country is predominantly contributed by market borrowing. And debt servicing, another important aspect of public expenditure. Debt servicing was nearly, on an average, 24.3% of budget expenditure that goes to debt services, and defense expenditure that consists of nearly 16.8% of the budget. So this is, these two are very important in the expenditure aspect of public debt. And tax revenue of the union government on an average, 285 crores of revenue that comes from non-tax revenue, whereas 1,284,000 crore that comes from tax revenue. So these are some of the data that I would like to give, but I think I can give presentation to explain the recent budget aspect, recent union budget of the country. So I think I would like to stop at this level because it is too early. Still, I would like to stop at this level. When we talk about sharing tax revenue, the Finance Commission that shares only income tax and excise duty with state governments, and all other taxes are not.
சார்
நான் அடுத்த கிளாஸ் கண்டினியூ பண்ணிக்கிறேன்.
ஓகே சார்.